As a bank that focuses on business, we work with business leaders all day, every day. We have a front row seat to what's working and what has potential. The First Business Bank podcast is dedicated to sharing insights to help you work better, smarter, and faster to achieve your goals. Let's get into the show.
Hello, I'm Mark Malloy, CEO of First Business Bank. I'd like to welcome you to another episode of the First Business Bank podcast. Today's topic is business email compromise. This is an important topic and one that every business owner and leader needs to be vigilant with. Today, I'm joined by three of my colleagues who will introduce themselves. Teresa, we'll start with you.
Thank you, Mark. My name is Teresa Weiss, and I'm the Managing Director of Compliance and Risk Management. I've been with First Business Bank for 27 years, long time. And my team manages fraud, suspicious activity, compliance, and then other risks to the company.
Thanks. Don?
I'm Don Wilcox, Director of IT Security and Compliance. I am celebrating my 25th year at the end of this year with First Business Bank. And so my area, we focus exclusively on IT security, plethora of security issues, and then also on the IT compliance side.
Thanks. Kim?
Hey, good afternoon. Kim Preston. I am also a long-term veteran with First Business, 28 years. I am the Milwaukee Market Treasury Management Leader. I lead the sales team for the Milwaukee Market region. And so our goal is to work with clients to assist them in utilizing tools that we're going to talk about today as far as fraud mitigation, how to limit risks and create efficiencies for our clients.
Thanks. So Dawn, I'm going to start with you.
Okay.
What are we talking about when we say business email compromise?
Okay. Business email compromise. It uses the all-important email system as a medium to commit fraud, just in general terms. Criminals know that we work in our email systems all day long, and therefore it's easy to get our attention when a new email comes in, especially if it's from your CEO, for example. So one type of business email compromise is called CEO fraud. This is where the criminal poses as the company's CEO and sends an urgent email to an employee to initiate a funds transfer, for example, albeit the funds transfer goes to an account that is owned by the criminal. The problem comes in when the urgency conveyed in the email compels the employee to act quickly on the request, and they ignore company established procedures and protocols designed to prevent such incidents from happening in the first place. So there's two ways that criminals primarily use to pose as a company CEO. The first way is they use an email address that appears to be from your CEO. However, the email address is slightly amiss in its spelling. So for an example, an email from someone at pizza.com may actually come in with pizza misspelled with an extra Z, for an example. And we all know we're really busy all day long. So if you don't look very closely at the address, you may never notice that the difference is in the spelling of that word. And criminals are counting on this happening because we're all such busy people during the day. The second way is where the criminal has duped the CEO into providing their user ID and password. Usually it's in response to an urgent email that they receive from Microsoft that says, if you don't log in right now, you're going to lose access to your Microsoft account. Well, who wants to lose access to their Microsoft account, right? So it's a very authentic looking web page that comes in then, and it appears where the CEO then logs in to protect their access to that account. But unknowingly, what they're doing is the criminal has just harvested their credentials, which gives them full access to that account, who now can control all incoming and outgoing emails from that CEO, including manipulating that email conversation between the criminal posing as the CEO and the person who's actually doing that funds transfer for them. Another type of popular business email compromise is called the bogus invoice scheme. And this is where the criminal pretends to be a supplier or vendor of the company, and they send an invoice with an altered payment instructions. Sometimes they may even include a friendly reminder on the invoice that their routing number and account number has recently changed, albeit the account is owned by the criminal. So similar methods are used to pose as this supplier or vendor as are used in the CEO fraud scenario, such as using a slightly different domain name in the email address or the supplier or vendor's credentials have already been harvested. So these are the two most common types of business email compromise that you hear about today.
Thanks, Don. Teresa, can you give us some examples of the things that Don was talking about?
Sure. So, unfortunately, at First Business Bank, that is one of the biggest frauds that we're seeing. And we've actually seen a bit of an uptick in 2020 as it relates to business email compromise. And really, I think Dawn explained it very well in that an employee of a company has their email compromised. They may have clicked on a phished site and entered their credentials, and then the fraudster then kind of watches the traffic. And if they see bank account numbers or personal information, they'll harvest that. So we've seen a fair number of incidents in which an employee, typically it would be someone in a finance department, an office manager, someone that may be responsible for either approving or generating accounts payable or paying invoices, and they will get an email saying, hey, we just changed banks, so here's some new payment instructions. And an ACH or a wire will be originated and could be 2-3 days or 2-3 weeks. Be where the person that originated the funds doesn't realize that the funds were actually sent to a criminal. And what usually happens in those situations is that the real vendor, so the vendor that they have engaged and do work with, will say, hey, you're past due on your invoice. And then that's when they call First Business Bank. And unfortunately, it's too late because the funds have been sent electronically, whether it's a wire or an ACH, and we're no longer able to get the funds back for the client.
So how common is this?
Well, I actually pulled some numbers for First Business Bank clients that we've had. We've had last year we had 27 cases for the thwarted amount. So the amount was $1,400,000 roughly. But that's not the losses. So the good thing is that we have lots of mitigants in place, and our clients do as well to mitigate the risks. But the amount that was thwarted was $1,400,000. The actual loss for our clients was $45,000. So that's the good news, is that we are able to stop a lot of this from happening. Now, that was 2019. 2020, year to date, as of November 30th, is the same number. So 27. Again, last year's numbers were annual. The potential loss was also $1,400,000, so running really about the same, but the dollar losses were almost $500,000 because there were some very large ones that were authorized, and by the time the clients realized that they had paid the fraudster, we were no longer able to get the funds back.
You know, to add something onto what Teresa said, you know, as far as the email compromise, a lot of times when the email is coming from the CEO or the CFO or whatnot, they don't really question it as much. So that's why a lot of times they'll react right away, because the man, you know, the CEO is saying, hey, get this wire out immediately. And so, you know, they react because of who's sending it and kind of forget that they're not, you know, going through their normal processes as far as getting correct controls and dual controls in place or whatnot because of who's sending it to them. So I guess that's one thing, if anything, that we really try to emphasize is, you know, does that email that's coming from the president or the CFO, is that kind of the typical format that they would send? You know, how are they signing it? You know, some of those kind of things to look at. But again, people, I think, get alarmed when they see, oh, you know, the president's saying I got to get this out the door now. And so they react.
Yeah, and that's an important point, Kim. Dawn pointed this out as well, that there's always a sense of urgency. And I will say that those large losses that we saw were because people circumvented their normal procedures and their normal policies because someone of, you know, executive management made this request, or so they thought. So that's an excellent point, that there's the sense of urgency and there's the circumvention of normal procedures or controls.
Yeah, I think it's important as we have this conversation, we're really talking to the leaders of our clients, our prospects, but really any business, that they really have the tone starts at the top as it pertains to taking care of the company's treasury, so to speak, right? That need to go work fast, to be efficient, to please those that are asking, cannot ever trump safe and sound practices and staying within the preset policies that our clients, many of which have set, and time after time over the years. It's kind of the same thing in the sense that people went outside of normal procedures, or they worked against sort of their own original intuition. This didn't seem right. It seemed odd, but it was coming from the president. It was coming from this person or that person, and they act in sort of the spirit of, you know, pleasing the boss, so to speak, and not really thinking about the extras. And, you know, there's, you gave some statistics. What's really not in there, though, is there's times where it's been thwarted on our end simply out of the fact that it just was, that it was out of the ordinary for us and how we deal with the client, right? And so maybe nobody thought about it first or thought enough about it first at the client level, but when it got to the bank, it was sort of like, hey, this is the way you guys normally do it. You know, we have other processes in place, I know too, which we'll get to in a little bit here, but Don, maybe that's a good segue for you as kind of what things put companies at risk in this regard.
Yeah, so I think that there's three buckets to take away from here, some information. The first one is lack of the employee training that happens potentially. You know, how to spot a spoofed email like the one that appears to be from your CEO, just being very cognizant and just monitoring your emails and just always looking for the exception or the thing that just doesn't look right, feel right, you know, just doesn't seem right to you. Always question something like that. The other thing is how to spot a phishing email, one that appears that comes from Microsoft saying, hey, you got to log in here or you're going to lose your access to your account. So that's where they're harvesting credentials. Think about the emails that you get from your ID department, your support department, and decide, you know, do they normally send out these emails? Do I normally get these kinds of emails from Microsoft that asking me to log in? Always question something like that because it's probably something that's trying to be phished on your behalf. And then the other thing is training on the importance of adhering to company policies and procedures that we've already talked about, the ones that have been designed to protect your organization. Even if it's an email from a CEO, you can't be faulted if you question it legitimately. If it just didn't feel right, doesn't sound right, you're asking me to bypass policies and procedures. I think there's an appreciation on any level to make sure we're following those procedures because they're meant to protect a company. The next thing is really important is the lack of using multi-factor authentication. Almost everyone uses Office 365 today, which means you can log into your email account from anywhere within the world, anywhere. And that means anybody can log in as long as they get your password. So it's imperative to implement multi-factor authentication to add that second factor of identification for you other than just a simple password. Because simple passwords, as we know, they can be easily intercepted. They can be guessed. They can be gleaned from like your Gmail account if you're using that same account for your network account or your Office 365 account. There's many, many ways of getting hold of passwords, and so passwords are just not enough. Multi-factor authentication is just so critical in this time and age because of these types of risks that happen all the time. Once a criminal has unauthorized access to your email account, as I mentioned, they can go undetected, sometimes indefinitely. And then this also allows them to impersonate and direct others through that email communication since it's such a widely used medium for business. So they can basically take over a business just by having access to critical email accounts. And then the last thing that I would want to point out is lack of email filtering technology and endpoint threat detection technology. Those two items, what they do is one of them can proactively detect spoofed emails. So if you get an email that looks similar to your CEO's name, these kinds of systems can pick up on those anomalies and raise red flags for you to investigate, to know that somebody's trying to spoof your CEO, for instance. And the other thing is then endpoint threat detection technology, and that's blocking suspicious activity altogether or malware that may be present. Just being able to pick up on those things is just so critical for any business to have in place.
Good, thanks. So Kim, I'm gonna go to you now. You're the front lines, face-to-face with clients and prospects every day, all the time. What are the things you're talking about with them on ways to reduce risk?
So to piggyback on what Dawn said earlier, too, it's all about education. So when we're meeting with clients, it's something we talk about regularly as far as the fraud trends that are out there, so that they're sharing that across their teams. And I actually like to share actual stories of fraud occurrences. I mean, obviously not sharing names of clients, but real life occurrences that we've had in the bank itself as far as clients that have been impacted, because that tends to resonate more with clients when they say, oh, it really does happen. Because it's not a case of if it happens, it's when it's going to happen. Exactly. Because it's inevitably, everyone's going to be impacted at some point. So again, it comes back to the education. You know, does your staff, are they educated on the current trends? Do they know how to detect, you know, an email scenario? Do they know to question, you know, when the CEO, they do get an email from the CEO requiring a wire, which is out of their realm. Do they know, hey, I should question this and I need to pick up the phone and either call, you know, the CFO or call the client or whatnot. So again, email is not the answer when you want to verify something. It's physically picking up the phone and talking to an individual. We had a case, you know, with a client a while back, a wire fraud, when they were dealing with a client overseas and because of time zone change and whatnot. And again, the president is actually the one who initiated the wire, received a request with different bank instructions. Didn't question it because it was an invoice he knew was due and whatnot, but initiated the payment. And his reasoning for not picking up the phone was the time zone change because it was calling China. So picking up the phone is probably the best rule of thumb as far as physically talking to someone to verify something before you're letting the dollars go out the door. No, the out-of-band authentication is super important. Another thing that Dawn talked about, because it's just that extra layer of security before, you know, the funds are going out the door. Though everyone in the company should be understand what the policies are as far as payment, not just the people that are dealing with it, but that everyone's aware of what's going on from a policy standpoint when there is a fraud incident, what to do, who to contact, who to get involved. So that's what I guess the biggest thing is we try to educate. When we're meeting with clients, we're continually telling them what's new in the world as far as fraud, what's the recent experiences we've had with other clients. Because real life, again, like I said, real life examples is very telling.
Yeah, and I would add two very, very simple things to what Kim has said as far as education goes. And one is so picking up the phone, but calling a phone number that you have or that a client has on their own system, not using a phone number that maybe is in a spoofed website, and not using a phone number that's in the
Good
communication,
point.
Whether it was email or otherwise. So use a phone number that you've got on your system. And then just the other thing too, as I pointed out earlier, you know, sometimes the bank can recover funds, but you have to be really fast. So checking your account, clients checking their accounts every day, and just, you know, questioning things that may not look right. Like, wait, why did we send, you know, that $10,000 wire out when that was not something that we expected to do? So so it's about being proactive at calling, and it's about looking at your account, looking at the activity as quickly as you can, and calling us if you think that there's a problem, calling the bank, because we have been successful at getting funds back, but the more time that goes by, the less likely we'll be able to recover anything.
Yeah, we talk, I use the word vigilance at the beginning, and that's really true. Some of it is just kind of old-fashioned, the way you used to do business. You got to keep doing business that way, even in this world of, you know, more technology and speed of service and speed of delivery, but it still is pay attention to your accounts. You know, what's going in, what's going out, separation of duties and responsibilities within your company as well, all these different things where, and, you know, an appropriate backup when people are off, sick, on vacation, what have you. They're really kind of really simple things too that matter. So if I can ask, you know, one more question here, and Teresa, I'll start with you on this, is, you know, what should a company do when they realize they are a victim? You guys touched on a little bit.
Yeah. No, great question. Thank you for asking. It's really call the bank ASAP. Don't don't email, call. It's going to depend a little bit on who the victim is, but the FBI gathers all of the information on a website called ic3.gov, and they have been successful as well at recovering funds. Reporting an incident on ic3.gov, and then contacting local law enforcement. That's an important thing to do. Unfortunately, law enforcement isn't always able to do that, but I would say the ic3.gov can be very effective.
Well, Don, Kim, and Teresa, thank you for taking the time to share your thoughts and experiences with our audience today. And to you, our audience, thanks for listening on our conversation, and we hope you found this topic helpful and applicable to your company. Let us know if there are other topics or information you'd like to learn more about, and join us next time on the First Business Bank podcast.
If you want more content like what you just heard delivered straight to your inbox, go to firstbusinessbankpodcast.com. And if you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to the First Business Bank podcast wherever you listen to podcasts. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, please leave a quick rating of the show. Thanks so much for listening. First Business Bank, member FDIC.